Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to the February meeting at the Pinelands Commission. Call meeting to order. Could we have a reading of the Open Public Meetings Act, please?
As for notice of this meeting of the Pinelands Commission, we do it in compliance with the requirements of the Open Public Meetings Act by providing notice to all municipal and county clerks in the Pinelands area and to Secretary of State on December 18, 2014. And the commission officially designated newspapers on December 18, 2014, and by posting a copy on the bulletin board in the commission office.
Okay. Call the roll.
Sure. Commissioner Ashman?
I'm here.
Commissioner Avery?
I'm here.
Commissioner Brown?
Here.
Commissioner DiBello?
Here.
Commissioner Gerland?
Here.
Commissioner DeLetta?
Here.
Commissioner Jackson?
Here.
Commissioner Danron?
Here.
Commissioner Lloyd?
Here.
Commissioner McGlinchey?
Here.
You're all thinking this is looking so good.
Yeah.
Commissioner Cricket?
Here.
Commissioner Quinn?
Here.
Commissioner Rowan Green?
Here.
Commissioner Witt?
Oh, damn.
Here.
Almost.
95%.
Almost.
All right, could we all please rise and join me?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, I told you we should receive copies of the minutes of our last meeting on January 16th in the packets. May I hear a motion for adoption? And a motion, a second. And a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor of their adoption, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the minutes are approved. Okay, next we'll have reports from committee chairs.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Personnel and Budget Subcommittee met on February 3rd, 2015. We adopted the minutes from December 2nd, 2014 meeting. Our Executive Director, Jessica Lynch, reviewed the financial statements and the November and December check registers, electronic disbursements, and application fees, and found them all in order. There was a discussion concerning the potential purchase of a generator or generators to keep the commission functioning in emergencies. We have a portable generator. It's not sufficient to run both buildings. The committee really wanted the staff to check into a generator that would run this building so that we could function out of this building in the event of a power outage, an extended power outage, and we're going to work on costs for that. And Michelle Russell provided an update on employee actions. And then we met in closed session. And that's my report.
Any commissioners with any questions?
I just have one. I apologize for not making the meeting. It was the last minute. I was actually involved in some union business. and I couldn't make it. I apologize for not making it. I did see the literature on the generator, which, as you know, is not even close. Being able to do it. You're going to need at least a 20 kW to crush this building.
We knew we needed a much bigger generator. The idea of hauling it out of the barn, running extension cords, didn't seem practical.
It's not going to provide you. I got something bigger than that in my house for portable, and it's not even close to power to build it. But you need the 20 kW for it.
So we need to get a price and see what the difference is.
All right, thank you, Commissioner. I have the summary of our meeting minutes from the Personnel and Implementation Committee, which met January 30th. We adopted our minutes of the previous meeting, which was actually back in October 31st. We also recommended to you the certification of Quantico Township's ordinance, which will allow mixed-use development as a condition of use in their neighborhood commercial zone. That is on our agenda today. We recommend adoption of that to you. Next, we discussed our interest in reviewing our memorandum of agreement procedure and language in the CMP regarding the memorandum of agreement. And we took no action. I suggested at that meeting that I would like to create an advisory committee, an ad hoc advisory committee that could report this and include not only interested commissioners, but members of the public and members of representatives of various government levels, local, county, state, so that we could take input and see whether or not there is merit in trying to give greater definition to the MOA section of the CMP. I also, after the meeting, sent an email message to the commissioners inviting feedback. I've heard from many of you. I appreciate that. I've also had occasion to talk with Director Wittenberg, get some feedback from the staff through her on this. So while I'm not ready to make any announcement on it today, I hope to be able to do so at the next P&I meeting in 2 weeks, and move forward with that. And of course, if any commissioners do have anything they'd like to add, contribute to that discussion, please feel free to get in touch with me between now and that meeting. All right, we also met in closed session to discuss litigation matters. And when we returned from closed session, we actually functioned as the full commission. We had many commissioners who were visiting the P&I committee that day. We had 9 total, and we function as a full commission and adopted Resolution PC4-15-02 entitled Confidentiality and Privilege of Certain Documents. And we're eight affirmative votes. As a result of passing that, we have some restricted access to some documents that I would encourage all the commissioners to take a look at them and take some time to look at them this afternoon following the meeting. So that was the extent of discussion. Any questions or comments?
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I commend you for efforts to, on the initiative to regarding the MOA process. I think it's essential, it's fair for our staff, and given the events of last year, certainly it's high time that that's looked at deeply, especially your invitation to be inclusive with members of the public and other agencies or levels of government. I think it's excellent.
Thank you.
Looking forward to all that.
Okay, there's no other comment. I'll turn it over to Executive Director for this.
Thank you. I just wanted to say one thing about the documents before all opportunity to race over to look at that. The stack of documents is big. There's two complete sets in the library now. Between Jess and I, that was the best we could do.
So we'll take turns.
Yes, or schedule another time, or we'll work on making more copies, but there are two sets in there now. Justin passed around a letter. You recall the never-ending Tuckahoe Turf Farm issue. We had been in discussion with the applicant, landowner, as well as the soccer sponsoring organizations who are running events on the Tuckahoe Turf Farm without approval, inconsistent with the CMP, inconsistent with the deed restriction on the land. We had come to what we believe was an agreement with them for us to develop a pilot program consistent with the CMP. We went through rulemaking and addressed the bigger issue of ag and alternative uses of ag land beyond straight-up ag, weddings and wineries, softball buildings on cornfields, and all of those things. The applicant went to Hamilton. We issued inconsistent CF. They went to Hamilton. They got their approval, which didn't include the two-year limit that we wanted. Hamilton claimed they couldn't do it. We were trying to work our way through that when next thing we knew, the bill was posted for the Senate Economic Growth Committee for yesterday. So the bill was up yesterday in the committee. Late Wednesday, Stacy and I got together and prepared a memo that went to that committee, and I went to the committee to testify yesterday morning on the bill. First, I got to sit through a really lengthy and interesting discussion on shark fins. And then we got to our bill. I had spoken to Senator Whalen before the meeting and Senator Lesniak. The hearing went very well. It's always good when you go before a legislative committee with a solution rather than just saying no. I made them aware of where we were and what our plans were to go forward on this issue. They were good with that, very positive, and Senator Lesniak chose to hold the bill and gave me 6 months, and they changed it about 4.5 months because of the summer break, to come back to him with anything. You know, originally they wanted to see the pilot program. I said, that's rulemaking, we couldn't do it that quickly, fine. You know, so we'll start more quickly. So for at least 4.5 months, I don't believe there'll be any further legislation. So that was a good outcome, and now we will get to work on the pilot program to look at this ag issue, which means I think we have a perfect opportunity for our ag committee to get together and help us with this and start to bring in some people. And that'll be good.
I'd like to thank you and Stacy for making that happen yesterday. That was a very nervous moment. We certainly were drawn to the brink. It could have been disastrous if we passed that bill. I'm very grateful.
So the bill is now full.
Yep.
For what?
Well, in 4.5 months, right before the summer break, I just need to let Lesniak know that we're moving.
No, I understand, but he'll go by what progress. He'll go by what progress you're making.
Yes. He was very supportive.
Yeah. Let me add my thanks, but ask you, remind me, what's the status of soccer play right now and before this spring?
They, assuming we get through the Hamilton thing with 2 years, they will be playing at that reduced schedule we worked out, eight two-day events, less fields, that all those terms will hold.
Mr. Chairman, can I make a statement?
Sure.
Nancy, you did a very good job with Chuck on this. I just think it's a disgrace for our own Congress to hold us hostage like this. I mean, if the bill is worth passing, pass the bill. Don't hold us hostage. And I just think this is a terrible way, and I hope this is not repeated in the future, because this is not a good way to do business in our state.
I wish the bill had never been introduced. We don't get to control that.
I agree, but I think the good news is that it seems the legislature at least was listening to us now. We've had difficulty getting their attention, and I think yesterday was an obvious success.
It was a very obvious success. Well, I think we should
enjoy.
Too much.
Celebrate.
Blow on the flame a little bit. Yeah. Yes, it was good. I thought I was going to get it. There's been some press about Woodland Township and the Park Preserve and issues there, that Woodland Township is very unhappy. I attended a meeting with Woodland Township and DEP, Richmond Asian Assistant Commissioner Lynn Fleming from Forestry. I was really only there because Woodland's in the Pinelands and they just like to keep me informed, but there's just a real rub between the town and the Park and Preserve. DEP is helping with some fire concerns they had, but there's not really a role for us at this point. Woodland's just not happy with the new ownership of land that they used to have more access to than they do now. And then there was some angst about forestry application we had in, and whether it should be a public or a private. All the Park and Preserve applications we have viewed as private applications. They're a private owner, not a public owner. And that seems to have calmed down as well. Not because, you know, we just made our position known, and we work with the Attorney General's office a bit on ownership. Apparently DEP contributed, I think, 40% of the money to buy the land, but then through their deed gave up their rights to make decisions or do anything, and they're not happy about that now, but I'm sorry. And then they said, oh, we'll just bring it in as a public. And I said, you can't, New Jersey Conservation Foundation. Only DEP could bring it in as a public. And to us, they're not the owner. So that seems to have quieted down once everybody realized they couldn't do that. And we'll see if it pops back up. Municipal Council meeting was this week. It was rescheduled from January. They once again did not have a quorum, but they had a really rocking crowd there, and it was very active and lots of discussion. There was a nice presentation from Rob Auermold from Wharton. So it was a good meeting, and they're energized again to try to figure out how they can get 15 mayors in the room at once. And again, offered to help them.
Could I just go back, Nancy, to the Park and Preserve? Mm-hmm. Do we have any pending applications before the commission worked in on that property?
There are pending applications, Commissioner, but they're all private development applications. They would not be what the commission would see as a public development application.
But they continue to do work on the site around the property? Or
yes.
Okay. And I can take a look at those.
Yes.
Thank you.
I think the one before us now has like three areas of thinning.
Yes, I think my recollection is there's a forestry application and there's a reconstruction of a dam that we have, and those are the two off the top of my head.
But those applications do not affect the town. They're not applications to the town,
correct?
They're
applications to the town?
That's right.
To us for private development?
Or are they just between us?
Well, we will clarify. It's not a typical residential subdivision or a commercial building, but there's these private development applications, forestry, reconstruction of a dam, all get certificates of filing. They all have an obligation to go to the municipality to secure whatever permits or approvals they may need, just like a residential subdivision or other development.
I understand, yeah. Okay, thank you.
The only thing I wanted to mentioned was there's been some press lately about a New Jersey Natural Gas pipeline and some residents outside of the Pinelands who have been complaining about it. There's a part of that route that would go through the joint base. We have no application in-house, so that's why we haven't mentioned it. We read about it. We have had some very preliminary discussions a while ago when they were thinking about it, looking at routes to get guidance, but we have no application in-house, nor do I know when we'll get one. But it is getting some press, so we have no application.
You know, people talk about the joint base, so they were the permitting authority, and I noticed that at least some of the routes I've heard about go through the preservation area on the base. So I think people should sit up and take notice.
Well, the applicant knows that it's not the base, it's us, so.
That's what I mean. Right. They haven't applied for it.
No, they haven't applied anywhere, Grant. I don't think they picked a route yet, but I really don't know. I mean, they came in, they said, this is what we're thinking about. We talked about the base and what the restrictions were, so they knew.
Yeah. But I just meant, because it's on the base, it doesn't mean you can do anything you want.
Yeah. We were very clear with them about what the limitations were on the property and what on that.
Thanks for
clarifying. We'll come back in with whatever route they choose, and then we'll start the process.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
And that's all I have.
I have a comment.
Sorry.
For the executive director. Yesterday I noticed the sign we have, the Pinelands Reserve, is that the commission sign? I saw some men out there working. They apparently were trying to dig holes. They had some poles. So I went past today and we have a new Pinelands Reserve sign in place. But I was just amazed, you know how frozen the ground is. And
yeah.
They were really tired. They had their pickaxes out and everything.
Oh, did you make them do that yesterday in that kind of weather?
So, you pick that day of all. Every day of the year.
Sinorama is the name of the
company. Beats today, right?
Yeah, that was a project that was funded by federal transportation funds many years ago, and that sign on the bypass up the street was hit twice now because they did not put it in the proper location. We had wanted it higher up on the embankment so that, you know,
wouldn't get it.
You would hit the embankment first before you guys hit our sign. Unless you were trying to hit our sign. So we may find out something later. But so now it's in the right location finally, and they did a very good job.
Thank you.
But we didn't make them do it on a cold day.
No.
That's great. It's like spring compared to today.
We're getting cool punishments.
Director.
Good morning, commissioners, members of the public. A couple of items I just wanted to mention. Kind of procedurally on the Hamilton Soccer application. I just wanted to note that we had received in from the applicant a request to amend their certificate of filing to include lands in Winslow and Waterford. That request of amendment is under review now. Just to refresh everyone's memory, we issued a certificate of filing for the proposed use in just Waterford. The certificate of filing in just Hamilton. And the certificate of filing indicated the proposed use was inconsistent with our rules. We will be reviewing the information to add Winslow and Waterford into the certificate of filing and ultimately issue an amended certificate of filing. That's just a procedural issue. I'm not commenting on the substance of it. That's just procedural. And another procedural aspect is we have now received in the information from Hamilton that constitutes an approval. We have to review that information, make sure we have all the information that's necessary for the commission's executive director to make a decision within 15 days of receipt of that as to whether to call up that approval for a commission staff public hearing that ultimately would make its way to you for a decision or to issue a letter of no further review. And I'm just noting that that information is now in the commission offices and it's under review.
I have a question for Chuck.
Chuck,
they're going to amend the certificate of filing, and how would that affect them accepting our proposal? Because I believe Waterford and Winslow are more confrontational or receptive to actually accepting the soccer. So how does that all play out with them actually accepting the proposal or the two-year whatever, that's pilot program or whatever we're proposing in 2 years?
Well, the way I presented the information was intentional to divorce those two issues at the moment. It's simply procedural issues that we're working on as we would with any permits or approvals that come into the commission. The question that you're asking, Commissioner, is yet to be to unfold and to answer.
Will that complicate the process? And would you reckon it would complicate or lengthen the process?
As flip as this sounds, it's not our problem. And the process, once we start to go into a process of pilot, it's not about talking about turf. It's about ag and activities on ag land. That's how we're looking at it, So they have to work it out with Waterford and Wasteland.
I gotcha.
I have a follow-up question, Chuck, and I want to assume that the same way that that you guys listed the CMP permitted uses in certain growth areas, that the municipality has the option to pick and choose of those permitted uses what they want to allow. For instance, we don't take advantage of every permitted use under the sun that's permitted by the CMP. So I'm going to ask the question that if and when they work out the pilot program for all ag, throughout the Pinelands where it meets the criteria that we set up, I'm going to assume that the same thing applies, that individual towns may not want to take advantage of that pilot program. Would that be a true statement?
I'll defer to either.
I think that would be one of the questions for the commission to consider. Do you want municipal participation in the pilot program to be voluntary or mandatory?
If in fact they work out a pilot program, I do believe that the municipality should have a say on whether or not they would want to see this occur in their town. Similar to the permitted uses that are already listed in the CMP. To do a mandatory like we did in rural management, for clustering, where it was mandatory, in so many words, that may not swallow real well with towns. Okay, and it's just a thought. And that's one of the reasons why I think that going back a couple of years now that we need to formulate an agricultural committee. Similar to the P&I, P&B, P&C, STP, all those committees. We need to do that. And Paul should be the chairman, even though he has a conflict of interest.
That way he can talk.
No, that's a legitimate suggestion. Joking that, but it's a good suggestion.
It's food for thought.
He'll talk with him.
I just wanted to continue on. I had a couple of other items that I just wanted to mention. I wanted to follow up on our discussion from the last commission meeting about Southampton Township's municipal building. Southampton Township on Wednesday to discuss a development application with the mayor, one of the committee men, the township attorney, the administrator. The township assured me that it was not their intent to insinuate in any manner whatsoever that they've made decisions purchasing lands based on commission staff decisions. They were very clear on that. And we are now attempting, as the second part of the meeting that occurred on Wednesday, we talked a little bit about some tentative plans they have to expand their municipal complex. And they're going to be probably with our planning office to talk about prospects for rezoning to expand their municipal complex. For those of you that don't know, the Southampton Municipal Building is on the corner of Route 206 and Budtown Road and Retreat Road. I wanted to mention a public development application that's causing a minor stir from the past. The Cape May County Utilities Authority that runs the landfill in Cape May County received approval to expand the landfill, and I think it was back in about 2009 that occurred. Just for about a 90-acre expansion of the landfill, the provision was actually amended into your rules to allow that to happen. That's kind of background, but not the real issue at hand. As part of the development approval that subsequently came into the commission, the county had to address the presence of a red-headed woodpecker that had been found in a nest on the site. They addressed that by providing what I'll call generically a conservation plan. That conservation plan called for a formal deed restriction to be placed on an 11-acre area. The conservation plan also showed other areas on the parcel that were to remain wooded but not deed restricted. Fast forward now to 2014, end of 2014 and 2015, we have a development application into us proposing to develop a commercial use in the area that was to be reserved as wooded area but not necessarily deed restricted. And we're having discussions with the county over the requirement for that to be deed restricted. We've spoken to Utilities Authority staff, the executive director, we've spoken to the applicant, we've had discussions, we've offered solutions to what we believe to be the problem, but we still seem to have a fundamental issue of a disagreement about the fact that part of the area that we believe was proposed to be conserved as part of the application that was approved by the commission is now proposing to be developed, and the Utilities Authority is disagreeing with our interpretation. We'll be meeting with them and continuing to try to resolve that issue.
Chuck, do you think you could generate a map that showed all that from around that landfill?
Yes.
It would help to have it in hand. Thank you.
Yes, it's actually an excellent map that's part of the application.
Yeah, I remember there was a map when the first or second time came in.
What's the commercial use that they want to put in?
It's a natural gas fueling station. We don't understand all the details yet because the zoning's holding up all the details being provided to us by the applicant. But it's our understanding that they're going to use gas that's being generated by the landfill to fuel certain fleets of trucks.
Is it commercial or public?
Well, that's not clear to us exactly. It's been represented to us mainly it will be public, but we don't have the definitive answer to that question yet.
I hope the gas they provide is better than what they send to the Woodbine State School, because that's very difficult to operate the boilers with.
Yeah. And the last couple of items, and I'll be briefer. I just wanted to note, we set a meeting on February the 25th, meeting with Jackson Township permitting officials to try to coordinate better the activities of their office and our office in respect to helping applicants through the process. That's the end of my report.
And Riley is not here today, so we could gossip about him or just move on. He's in New York. He's not quite fabulous this time. Okay, so Stacey has an update on some...
Yes, on Garrison Parkway, to continue the trend of good news. I wanted to discuss the positive... All right, I'll try to talk louder since I don't have a microphone. Yes, but hear me. I wanted to discuss the positive outcome of the Garden State Parkway widening project as it pertains to land acquisition to memorialize the zoning, for secondary impacts associated with the widening project. So as you may recall, in 2009, the commission entered into a memorandum of agreement the Turnpike Authority for the widening of the Garden State Parkway between mileposts 80 and 30. And in the course of developing that MOA, the commission had concerns about potential secondary impacts associated with the project. The commission retained DERPC to do a secondary impacts analysis. And the end result was that secondary impacts were potentially identified for interchanges 68 and 58. And as a result, or as part of the MOA, the Turnpike Authority agreed to memorialize zoning on frontage lots located 1.5 miles along feeder road from these interchanges. At that time, there were conforming lots and non-conforming lots. For the conforming lots, we entered into a secondary impacts agreement with the Turnpike Authority, and I'll get into more detail about that, which required the Turnpike Authority to undertake the initiative to memorialize the zoning. With regard to undersized lots, the New Jersey Turnpike Authority put $915,000 into PCF, which was targeted to memorialize zoning for that initiative. It has now been more than 5 years. The secondary impacts agreement provided for the Turnpike Authority to have 5 years with a 1-year extension to obviate secondary impacts. The five-year period expired on January 5th, 2014. They were afforded a one-year extension because at that time they were still negotiating with one major property owner and two other property owners in the area. And they, in fact, the good news is they were able to close the deal on our property up in the vicinity of Interchange 69 right before the end of the year. The impact agreement called for total zoning to be addressed about 1,500 acres. Prior to December of 2014, approximately 900 acres had been purchased by the New Jersey Turnpike Authority or by the Township of Ocean. If you remember, the Horner property up in the vicinity, that was one of the acquisitions where zoning was...
That was the county.
Preserved the Horner property. It was a major acquisition, a very important acquisition. The acquisition that occurred on December 30, 2014 is also very important. 631 additional acres, which were formerly owned by George Cluin LLC, were acquired by the Turnpike Authority, and the Turnpike Authority will be transferring those to either a non-governmental conservation organization or a governmental entity in March. So at this point, 1,475 acres has been addressed up in the vicinity of Interchange 69. So I view that as a significant success. There's only a small amount of acreage left to be addressed in that area. There's a small amount of acreage left to be addressed at Interchange 58. As a result of that, and the fact that the five-year period has expired on the secondary impact agreement, I wanted to discuss with you today the need to amend that agreement. A number of things have happened since that agreement was executed. First of all, as I said, the Turnpike Authority no longer has an obligation. At the end of the 5 years with the one-year extension, that obligation to memorialize zoning transferred to the commission for a five-year period. And at the end of that five-year period, the monies would then go out of the escrow account and be returned to the Turnpike Authority. At the time that the agreement was executed, the commission was actively involved through the PCF fund in land acquisition and had an acquisition facilitator, or a land acquisition facilitator, to help bring entities together to try to make these acquisitions happen. At this point, the commission does not have a facilitator anymore. We're, you know, also significantly less, have less staff than we did at that time. As a result of that, and since the Turnpike hasn't stated its interest in continuing to pursue the acquisition projects that it has pending, I would like to ask for an oral motion today for staff to work with the Turnpike Authority's representative to amend that agreement to give the authority at least two more years to try to finalize the acquisitions that it has in process. And then also to change the extension provision to allow for additional extensions if the Turnpike Authority is still continuing to work towards the goal.
Any other motions to that effect?
I'll move it.
Second. Is there any discussion?
How much money is left and how many acres are we expecting to try to bring to buy in the next 2 years or 4 years, whatever the period?
Yeah, Commissioner White, I don't have that specific figure with me. They just took an additional $5 million out of the account. There was $10 million in the account additionally. So I don't think there is a substantial amount of money left. I will get that information for you all. Okay. Because it also includes the interest money that's in the account.
Did I understand these? They said there was 10 and they took out 5? Is that
they took out 5 for the latest acquisition.
So there may be around 5 left?
I think it's less than that because they also took out money for the Horner acquisition. They were allowed to remove money if the property was acquired by another governmental entity and moved into conservation. So those monies were already taken out in 2009. If I had to guess, there's probably between 1 and 3 million, maybe, if that much, if you count in the interest, but I will get precise figures for you. There is not much land left to be acquired. There's maybe 50 acres or so between the two interchanges.
I think that the extension makes a lot of sense. We don't have the consultant anymore, and it seems they're doing a good job. Let's let them continue.
Yeah, I think I know there was a lot of concern at the time that when we did the agreement,
I think Turnpike has been a vigilant participant and has really done a good job here. A lot of good land has been preserved as a result of this, in this effort.
Commissioner McGlinchey.
Yeah, Stacy, it seems like there's a real de minimis amount of acreage is still left to be preserved. And I just have a little bit of a problem with an additional two-year extension. I don't have a problem with a two-year extension, but it sounds like there's still an open end at the end that we can grant more extensions after 2 years. I would feel more comfortable with a two-year extension with only one more year after that. That's going to give them a total of almost 9 years to finish up, you know, 50 acres. I think that it doesn't hold them their feet to the fire by allowing them, or at least have an idea that at the end of 2 years, I might be able to get more extensions. Extensions, not just 1 year.
Commissioner, I disagree with you. The only reason that I more open-ended, it would still be the requirements would still be the same as they are now. They would have to demonstrate to the commission that they are in fact continuing to move forward, that they have a contract.
It's easy to show that.
But the other thing is the agreement itself has only a 10-year shelf life, of which we only have 4 years remaining. So if we do 2 years with one more year, as you said, it's nine. I didn't know if it was worthwhile to have that additional year.
But then make it two. But the way the language is now, it would appear that you could give more extensions even beyond 10 years.
I don't know. I doubt that the Turnpike Authority would be willing to do that, in all honesty.
Well, I think it's really what we're allowing them to do.
Sure.
It shouldn't be the tail wagging at all.
So you're requesting that the building...
That's a thought. I know. I would feel more comfortable if it was 2 years and 2 years just a
no
year
more
change.
Than 2 years.
And then hold people to the fire
on.
But if we do 2 years, if at the end of 2 years there's money left, under the agreement that money goes back to them after 10 years?
No, it was or 10 years from execution of the MOA, which was January 5th of 2009.
Well, then why it come to us?
Because
well, it doesn't come to us. That's,
it does not
come to us. Back to
that. That's what I'm saying. Why doesn't it come to us?
Because
that's
that
not the agreement we
was not the agreement that was negotiated at the time.
I understand, but they want to amend it now, right?
Actually, I think to some extent, we're looking to amend it because it's for the benefit of this commission for the continued acquisition.
Well, the way it really benefited is to give us the money at the end of the 10 years. You'd have made the deal.
I think that's worth considering because the incentives now, I mean, I think they've been working and they've been succeeding, so I don't want to complain about them, but the incentives are, if they don't do something, they get the money back. I think it's worth at least approaching them and say, let's deal with the money issue as well.
I mean, I'm looking for the authority to go back to them and negotiate, recognizing they may not agree to that, but sure, absolutely.
Give us the money now. They don't have to worry about 2 years.
Okay, so Commissioner Lloyd moved in. Would you amend your motion
restrictions? Yeah, the motion is to authorize staff to negotiate with them for an extension and to include consideration of the money coming back to us.
Right.
And
I don't like the word consideration. I think that we should always go into it with that we want the money at the end of it and let them come back with the consideration.
I think Stacy has an instruction and it's a second. I forget your second.
I just want to make sure.
I'm greedy.
I understand Commissioner McGlinchey's point. However, again, as the agreement stands now, 4 more years, the money goes back to them. There's no incentive on their part to negotiate. I will try, but I would rather not see, if they're willing to continue to move forward with the items that they are still in negotiation for, I think that's the benefit of the kindness of this commission.
Yeah.
Just to make sure I understand this, they have 50 acres left of their obligation.
Yeah.
And they have $2.5 million to buy 50 acres.
Right. Approximately.
And 3 years to do it.
Yeah.
And
so
we have
the motion.
Can we sign this motion,
Kelly?
The amendment motion?
We are, yes.
Did
you
vote on the amendment and then vote on the whole thing?
Yes.
Yes, I think so.
Are we
if you want to be able to, could you, if the seconder okay, can we just change the motion?
Yes.
If the seconder okay, can we just
change the motion? I don't remember who the seconder was.
So the motion now is that we authorize staff to negotiate an extension of time as well as a change in the allocation of the money at the end of the project.
At the end of 2 years or 4 years?
It might be at the end of 4 years.
It would be at the end of 4 years.
End of 4 years.
So we're going to give them 4 years to acquire this remaining land.
They now have that anyway.
Well, we do. The commission has 4 years to do it.
They have two. Right now, what I was suggesting to Ed, it's always a suggestion, Ed, is that a 2-year extension with a possible Additional 2 years, in 1 year increments.
Let's give them 2 years to start with, and give them the incentive, and then not foreclosing the possibility for another two.
Yeah.
Yep.
Is that okay? You and I.
And further suggested, if you don't include their obligation, money.
I understand that the motion on the table as it stands now is that staff would be authorized to negotiate with the Turnpike Authority to amend the secondary impact agreement to provide them with 2 more years to fulfill the obligation to memorialize zoning with the possibility of two additional 1 year extensions, and to discuss with them the commission retaining any monies in the escrow account should they not meet their obligations.
And the secondary agrees?
Yes.
Okay. All right, any further discussion on the motion?
Yep.
Yeah, oh, sorry, Commissioner Jackson.
I'm kind of a little, I'd rather see, I don't want it to appear that we're selling property for money. By us getting the money at the end of this, I'd rather them use it or let them have it. Let them have it back, but use it to buy land. They've been doing a good job up to now. It's only 50 acres. They should be able to accomplish that. But I think that's part of, it just doesn't look good when we say, we bargain with, we'll give you X amount of land if you give me X amount of dollars.
But the money that I'm referring to would go to land preservation, not just the uses we want.
Right.
I'm talking about putting the Pinelands Conservation Fund.
And then it would be our obligation.
And then it would be their obligation, our obligation, to go find it. I don't want to use it for that.
Yeah.
Maybe raises would be okay.
The underlying deal several years ago was that they would put up this land to purchase lands that would be, we were concerned about secondary impacts, that would be developed as a result of the expansion of the interchange. So I think that the underlying deal is we want to try to preserve land and reduce secondary impacts. And it appears that it's working well so far.
I'm good.
All right, any other discussion? All right, all in favor of the adoption of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay.
Thank you very much.
Anything else?
Yes.
The end of the director's report. Thank you, Madam Director. Okay, we have two public development project resolutions before us. The first, the staff is recommending that it pass, is for Egg Harbor City. We want to go first here. Motion towards adoption.
So moved.
Have a motion from Commissioner Glass, second by Commissioner Erland. Any discussion for that decision? Okay, all in favor of its adoption, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Let that carry. Next one is a resolution for two private homes.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Stacy, I don't have a problem. I don't have any, I'm not an acquaintance of Mr. Jacobson Hamilton. However, in the Hamilton Township, I believe this property abuts my property, quality. So I think I'd feel better recusing myself based on the Hamilton Township.
I would appreciate that. Thank you, Commissioner, for letting us know.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Okay, so Commissioner Glenn has recused himself. May I hear a motion for the adoption of the resolution for the private homes?
So moved.
We have a motion on that. Do we have a second? Yes.
Commissioner Brown.
Second. Any discussion on the motion? All in favor of its adoption, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Back down. Thank you. Okay, next, we have the municipal ordinance from Barnegat Township that I referred to earlier from the P&I committee. This would amend our land use ordinance to permit mixed-use development in the commercial zone. And I hear a motion for this. Okay.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? And seeing none, all in favor of the adoption of the resolution, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? That carries. Thank you. Okay, next, we'll take public comment on agenda items and pending public development applications, of which there is one, Egg Harbor Township MUA.
So I'm clear, the point of public comment is on agenda items, the ones that have been pending so far? because I have a comment on the executive director's report and the recusal that just went on.
Oh, okay. I think that should probably be held over for the full general public comment period, okay, which is coming up momentarily.
It's technically on an agenda item. I mean, the public comment on an agenda item, one of the items on the agenda is the executive director's report. So I'm publicly commenting on that, correct?
Well, I'll defer to council.
Thank you.
Sounds like council agrees.
All right, thank you.
Go ahead.
Two things. The New Jersey Natural Gas situation where I believe the executive director indicated that they'd come in some time ago and you discussed things with them. That again goes to my prior point and continuing point on this pre-application review process. Information is strategic. There are townships that are adopting resolutions in opposition of that gas pipeline. It's an enormous public dispute. The fact that they came into the commission and that was not public knowledge is significant. There are landowners who are not aware of their full rights, who are being approached for right away on that thing, that are getting, you know, there's both an economic component and there's a fairness component, there's a public interest component. So I would urge you in your deliberations on your MOA to expand it to pre-application contacts and have some public disclosure of that, such that the public can become aware of those kind of conversations. Because again, we're right back to where we were on the South Jersey gas dispute, that there was a pipeline application, there was an applicant seeking staff's consultation as to what the requirements were, and the public did not know that. So I think you gotta fix it. Second thing is that there were news articles referenced in the executive director's report.
Yes.
So I would just bring your attention to Philadelphia Inquirer news story that grew out of the planning and implementation committee that I think commissioners should be aware of as well. That was not made part of the executive director's report. If you're going to have news clips as part of your executive director's briefing of the commission, have 100%. Meaning every time the commission is mentioned in a news article, have a policy that the executive director gives you that clipping or something like that. Because okay, great. All right. Well, I'm working off the information I have as a member of the public.
Okay.
And all I heard was I didn't hear that article referred to. I think you need that article. Third point, did you guys alter your recusal policy? Because my understanding is your recusal policy is when you're recused, you left the room. Did that get revised somehow? Because I just saw recusal and I didn't see an exit.
That has not been revised. Commissioner Coletta has stated publicly that he chooses not to honor that policy, and that's his position.
And you choose not to enforce that policy?
We don't think that's our duty to enforce that policy.
So you have a policy, but you don't abide by it. You let ad hoc meet deviations based on a commissioner's own.
Respecting the commissioner's
wishes. Okay, I object to that.
Okay. Right, is there any other comment on public agenda? Right, so we're not going to move forward. There were two ordinances that were in our packet. They do not require commission action, but as is my practice, I open up to the commissioners if anyone had any comment on either the Barnegat Township Ordinance number 2335 or Dave Harbor Township Ordinance 29. Anyone? We'll move on. All right, so now we've arrived at the general public comment. There's probably a sign-in sheet to have that. And on that list. And before we, yes?
I have a question for Attorney Heisenman. I can wait until after general public comment.
Yeah, why don't you let
we'll let the public go first.
Yeah, thanks.
Before we adjourn.
Thank you. I just wanted to ask one thing before we start the public comment. At our session, P and I, the committee meeting 2 weeks ago, a lot of the members of the public turned out. We had public comment at other sessions too. Many people commented. And some of the comments that were made, we commissioners felt went beyond the pale. There were a lot of ad hominem attacks on staff members. We're here to hear the substance. You know, if people want to get up and make a comment about substantive issues before the commission, that's entirely appropriate. We would ask the courtesy that you please not make ad hominem attacks on our staff, and to use that as an opportunity to take pot shots. We really appreciate that. All right, having said that, let's start with public comment. All right, Mr. Wolf, you're up again.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Bill Wolf, Gordon Town. three quick points. We left the conversation last time at the end of the planning implementation. You discussed it earlier.
Yes.
About revising the CMP mower provisions. I would urge that you look very closely at the equivalent protection standard. It's very broad, very vague, allows a lot of discretion. I think discretion was at the heart of the dispute here as to how you went about determining equivalent protection. I would urge you to adopt technical standards, criteria, review methods, and a review process. Mm-hmm. That would promote transparency, predictability, certainty for applicants and the public, and as well as fairness. As a model, as an example of that, I offer, when I was at the EP, I drafted the Category 1 stream buffer regulations, which authorized, in certain instances, establishing a 300-foot buffer, allowed the applicant to encroach on the buffer to 150 feet under certain circumstances when there was an equivalent ecological function. That was the term we used, ecological function. We were told we had to do that at the time to provide flexibility to avoid takings claims where the arbitrary 300-foot limit would not stand in certain cases, so we had to have an exit to that. I think you have the same kind of process for your equivalent and protection standard. And subsequent to that broad standard in the rule, there was no guidance. Then the DEP subsequent to that developed a guidance document, and then developed a second guidance document, and then developed a technical manual as part of the stormwater rules. So that is a clear template, and we broke out the components of ecological function, and we established criteria and standards for each component of ecological function. You have the same problem before you. And it avoids the appearance issue with respect to money that Commissioner Jackson has raised, and it puts an applicant on notice as to what the technical standards are going to be. It's just good government. It's good environmental protection. I strongly recommend that you do it, particularly given the dispute we had on what that meant for the last mower. The other things you might want to beef up the definitions of what a public agency and a public purpose are, because, again, we saw South Jersey Gas as a private applicant being brought in under a public entity at the BPU. That was perceived as an abuse. There were some legal questions as to whether that was viable. You've got to clarify that. Secondarily, you could do the same thing for review, waivers for compelling public need and no feasible alternatives, because there could be applicants that are seeking waivers under the same kind of controversy. And again, you don't have any meat on the bones of those general standards. And since that would take regulatory amendments and technical work and public process, I urge you, because you now know your rules are deficient, you now know that there's applicants that may come forward, including New Jersey Natural Gas, that you want to impose some kind of administrative moratorium impending the strengthening of your rules to put safeguards in place. The model for that is the Delaware River Basin Commission, who did the same thing when they realized their fracking regulations were inadequate to evaluate fracking applications. They put into place an administrative moratorium on any applications pending revision of the rules. And I think you want to do that. Second point deals with the email issues. We had quite a discussion about the email issues last time. I think they clearly create an appearance that the agency, that the commission as a whole, and certainly its staff, were subject to what the political theorists call agency capture, and that undermines the public trust and confidence in the commission. And that should be, that's regardless of your position on the pipeline, you have to stand for your own integrity. And regardless of which way you believe, and this is not a hominem, this is a situation where you had your staff who report to you doing things without your knowledge that were policy-based. And I think you have to bring in your executive director and counsel under the commission's guidance and control, that you're the policy and they work for you. I was a school board member, and this was a persistent tussle dealing with the, at that time, the district superintendent and the relationship between the board. You have the same situation. I understand the tension, but you got to take, as one of the commissioners said earlier, the tail shouldn't be wagging the dog. And if you can realize that who's the dog and who's the tail with the turnpike authority, you need to realize who the dog and who the tail is with respect to your staff. And to go one step further, I unfortunately brought in last time a personal, I was named in some of the emails, so I took offense to that personally. But I'll cite instead a different scenario where one of the emails showed that your lawyer was coaching the applicant, advising the applicant about positions and perceptions of commissioners as a whole, where the public had made a presentation about an alternate route, and then your counsel suggested to the applicant that that alternative was, quote, I think the term used in the email was gaining momentum with commissioners, and that they had better do something to kind of, you know, deal with that issue because the commission was leaning that way. That to me is like, you know, come on. That's not only coaching the applicant, it's divulging information not otherwise available to the public, which was the legal basis of the resolution you passed, and that got some confusion at the end. The Attorney General apparently didn't know that the statute she was citing was the ethics statute. All right? And information not generally available to the public certainly is the perception of the commissioners with respect to which way they may or may not be leaning with respect to an alternative route. That's pretty serious. And the last point I make is a timing question. And again, it goes to the same issue with New Jersey Natural Gas. When and who and by what means was the executive director and the council authorized to negotiate a MOA with South Jersey Gas? I need to know the answer to that question because I checked the minutes and I remember I reviewed all my stuff and my notes back to the debates. And I frankly see the MOA transmitted to your attorney on March 4th, 2013. And that same attorney on July 27th, 2013 said, and it was, I'm paraphrasing here, but it's darn near a quote, we are not prepared to discuss a MOA. So, and I have Commissioner Ashman on tape saying that it was early in the process, this was September now, 6 months after you, months after that you had already been negotiating the language of the deal. You have a commissioner saying it's early in the process, we need to just tell the public no decisions made, we need to, you know, make that abundantly clear to the to a kindergarten level, I think the term was used. So the point is you have a process issue that you have to strengthen in the MOA, and it deals with the public and it deals with who makes decisions on the commission with respect to your staff versus commissioners as a whole. And the final point is there were quite a few emails to the governor's office in there. And under the Pinelands Act, the governor has a negative role. The governor can veto your minutes. That's how he can block what you do. That's a negative power. The emails disclose an affirmative power, meaning continuous involvement in the process and the day-to-day nuts and bolts that goes beyond merely observing the deliberations of the commission. It suggests some governor's office influence on both your staff and your deliberations that I think is not appropriate given your statutory in but not of status of the executive branch. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Cindy Richards.
Well, good morning, Cindy Richards from Tabernacle, New Jersey. I'd like to wish everybody a happy Valentine's Day. And notes to people, pink, mauve, red, and also happy President's Day. I think I'd also like to commend Commissioner Lobauer for the work that you're doing with the P&I committee and the development of an ad hoc committee. With President's Day and our dedication to democracy, I think it's extremely important, hearing what Mr. Wolf has said in the executive director's reports and various concerns, that the public, and we have a good attendance today, as well as Mr. McClinchy said, municipalities, that so many of us, either individuals, organizations, or government bodies, should be involved with the working of the commission. And I think the government transparency is something that we all are very interested in and we're striving for. So with Stacy said trend of good news, I think there's definitely something to be said here that we're trending in a more open way, and I applaud you there. I have one comment, I guess one question. This is for Chuck. What is the official status of the South Jersey Gas Pipeline application? Okay, so when the vote was taken a year ago, January, that not only defeated the MOA, it stopped and defeated and nullified the application. Is that the correct process description?
No, the MOA was the end of it. There was no separate application.
There's no separate application. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you. Ready?
Good morning, commissioners. Members of the audience.
I wrote a letter to the commission to present that at the...
Is this a Valentine?
Right? Yeah. It's also Friday the 13th, I think. I attended the Policy and Implementation Committee meeting, and observed the discussion about the review of the MOA process, and I came away from that with the concern that there was that it might not happen. There seemed to be not a necessarily an agreement that was something that was going to happen. So I wrote this letter because I wanted to point out that it's really old business. So I'm going to quick read this through here. The Pinelands Commission needs to review and strengthen the memorandum of agreement process now, and there is no clearer example of why you need to do this than the high cost of the failure of your proposed memorandum agreement with the Board of Public Utilities for the South Jersey Gas Pipeline. The public has requested that the Pinelands Commission review the memorandum agreement process for at least 2 years now, and it was a significant item commented upon during the plan review process that was allowed to disappear from that process. Now, I did some research for as far as like the timelines. On September 14, 2012, the Pinelands Preservation Alliance submitted extensive written comments requesting the amendment of the Intergovernmental Memorandum of Agreement provisions of the CMP. In their comments, they suggested that the commission should replace the existing CMP procedure with a revised procedure for public facility plans. And they not only provided extensive general recommendations in this regard, but they also provided extensive line-by-line edits for the actual language changes in CMP Section 7:50-4.52C intergovernmental agreements. Then on September 28, 2012, I submitted formal public comments during the plan review process on behalf of the Great Egg Harbor Watershed Association, first recommending the total removal of the MOA process from the CMP and as an alternative to adopt PPA's detailed recommendations. Then on October 23rd, 2012, the Pinelands Preservation Alliance released their 2012 State of the Pinelands report. On page 2 of this report, the PPA Executive Director recommends this key reform is number 6 that PPA thinks is most essential, and it relates to Intergovernmental Memorandum of Agreement rules reform. And they said the MOA procedure has become a real Trojan horse that is weakening the commission and the CMP from within. The procedure needs to be eliminated or at least reformed to ensure it is only used for genuinely public projects. All right, then from the minutes of the November 9, 2012 Plan Review Committee meeting, a summary of comments received report was presented, which highlighted that there were 16 public comments to reduce the number of intergovernmental MOAs / amend or approve CMP provisions regarding MOAs. And Chairperson Ashman noted that the MOA provisions were reviewed at length by a small subcommittee of commissioners in 2007. She suggested staff re-review the records from that time to determine whether the same issues exist and whether there is anything that can be done to resolve lingering or new concerns. Chairperson Ashman requested that the staff distribute the 2007 MOA review documents to the committee members for their consideration. Mrs. Brewer replied that the documents should be updated to reflect the existence of new MOAs completed since 2007. And Mr. Leggett added that a review of MOAs completed during the period since the previous plan review would be provided in the plan review progress report. Then from the minutes of the January 11, 2013 Plan Review Committee meeting, upon completion of discussion of all topics on the list, Ms. Wittenberg briefly reviewed the committee's observations, noted that the PDC program enhancements, use of the Kirkwood-Cohansey aquifer study results, MOAs, Blackhorn watershed protections, T&E species protocol and survey requirements, native vegetation standards, stormwater and planning redevelopment seem to have generated the most interest from committee members for consideration for the second round rule proposal. Then, from the March 8, 2013 meeting minutes of the Plan Review Committee meeting. Stacy Roth advised that the mechanism for memorandum of agreements had been reviewed in depth recently in response to public perception that deviation MOAs were being used increasingly more frequently. She stated that she would complete an internal review of the recent assessment of MOAs to identify concerns and potential solutions and return to the committee with any recommendations. Now, this is the last reference or data point I could find or recall, and I attended most of the meetings, regarding the response by the Plan Review Committee and the Finance Commission staff to address the public concerns regarding memorandum agreements during the plan review process. So I suggest that you not only owe it to the public to take up a serious review of the MOA process now, but you also owe it to yourselves to fix it now to prevent the tremendous cost in dollars, the tremendous waste of time, and the major loss of public confidence from another massive MOA failure because your current MOA process is fatally flawed. Thanks for bearing
really with me on that. Thank you for compiling that.
All right, thank you.
I would just like to point out that it never disappeared from the agenda of the Plan Review Committee and is in the Plan Review Report as being a recommended action.
Yeah, which is why we're talking about it now. Yeah, doing something formal. Okay. Thank you, Commissioner. All right, next, Mary Clemente.
Mary Clemente Morgan. I wear this sweatshirt, Protect Pinelands, and I hope everybody here has one of these sweatshirts or t-shirts to help remind them that that's what the purpose of this commission is. And I had seen on the agenda the fact that you wanted to limit the time. I came in a little late, so I apologize. To limit the time from 5 minutes to 3 minutes for public comment. And all I can say there is that that also appears to be an impropriety in terms of stifling the public. We understand that in terms of when we had the big issue with South Jersey Gas and the number of people that wanted to make comment, yes, absolutely, reduce the time to so more people can speak. But to come out in this particular point in time and say, you know, reducing, I mean, you haven't made an effort to stop anybody today. I don't know how long people were speaking, but I hope that this is not something that you're going to take forward in terms of the 3 minute, 5 minute. People need to get up and speak their mind, speak what's in their hearts, and from a standpoint of transparency, you need to hear what people are saying and what people are feeling. I think that there was one other comment that I had, but I didn't write it down, and I'm old, and I forgot, so I can't remember it.
Guilty.
But anyway, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, then Tony Delatovich. I'm sorry if I mispronounced your name.
That's okay. That's never done before. Tony Delatovich.
Okay.
I came here today to represent New Jersey Builders Association. I'd also like to just take a moment, based upon discussions that were held at this meeting, to just make a comment representing myself and my company. For NJBA, I was here 6 months ago, 9 months ago. I'm getting about 9 months. I was here a while back indicating that NJBA was encouraged to be working with the commission and the commission staff on trying to deal with issues, particularly stormwater, is what I'm interested in.
Yeah.
I just came to give a little update that we did a stormwater infiltration basin study, because that's one of the major concerns, especially in Pinelands, of how do we make sure that these basins work properly, and we encourage them to be used more and more if we can ensure them to work properly. We've completed a study with the assistance, it was New Jersey Bill Association and NJDEP, for a joint study, all volunteered from our part. And the Pinelands Commission staff worked with us, they were very cooperative and very helpful in looking at the basis of the Pinelands. That report is being finalized now by myself and a person from an engineer from Mazur Associates, and I'll go through NJBA review, and we'll have it out for you. And if you want us to come and brief to staff,
or I'm sure that would be great.
And it looks very encouraging on how we can ensure continued and then improved ways of infiltrating in the Pinelands. As my NJBA, that's why I came here. Now, as myself, Tony DiLorbico, and President Tony D, Environmental Permitting, the MOA discussions, I'd like to volunteer to help in that as myself. I've been Vice Chairman of the Ocean County Soil Conservation District for 15 years. I was elected and still serve on the State Soil Conservation Committee 5 years ago. I'm also Vice President of New Jersey Association of Conservation Districts, which is affiliated arm of the State Soil Conservation Committee. And I worked at EPA for 12 years, and at EPA I was the lead contact in the interagency agreement between Corps of Engineers and Region 2 EPA. I also had two responsibilities as a branch chief there, coordinated various memorandum agreements with various state local issues with the DEP, with the Army Corps of Engineers, even dealt with agencies in Puerto Rico, even though I don't speak Spanish, that was a big surprise doing that. So I volunteer my time. I have lots of experience in dealing with MOAs, and I'm more than willing to help and volunteer my time in that regard. And then just as an aside, I heard you made a comment, I don't go to policy in general, I heard you make a comment about the concern of trying to not have the public make specific comments directed specifically at staff. And I'm happy to hear you say that. As someone that deals with the public on a regular basis in the Ocean County Soil and State Soil Conservation Committee, and I always try to encourage the public to speak and speak their mind at First Amendment right, but not to be disruptive, and disruptive could be that making personal attacks. And there's a lot of discretion there, and I'm not a lawyer, but I understand lots of discretion and what that means. But there's also some case law I looked into all doing it for 15 years of what you can and can't establish. And there's no need to have to specifically establish a policy, but making comments like that, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's the end of the people on this. Is there anyone else?
Yes.
Arnold Fishman, Medford Lakes. I'm confused, as only an attorney can be, by the answer given to Sydney Richards' question about the status of the South Jersey Gas application. The answer seems to be that it from the commission is that it's over. I don't understand how that can be said in light of the fact that the matter is pending before the appellate division.
Yeah.
The issues that were raised by the applicant were that the decision was arbitrary, capricious, against the weight of the evidence, and that your determination, or some commissioner's determination, that the MOA is not an appropriate vehicle for a private organization was rulemaking without going through the rulemaking process. Those are the two issues that they have raised before the appellate division. Now, the appellate division cannot grant the MOA, but what they're asking the appellate division to do is to remand it back to this commission for a determination which would not be arbitrary, capricious, and against the weight of the evidence, and would eliminate the objection that they are not an appropriate entity to seek an MOA because they are private other than public. So it seems to me like this issue is not and will not be dead until the appellate division speaks and the time within which the applicant could petition the Supreme Court for review has ended. That's really the fear that many of us in the audience have with respect to this application, and yet this commission continues to take the position that there's nothing, that it's dead. It's far from dead until the appellate division speaks and the time for appeal, assuming that the appellate division affirms what the commission has done, the time for a petition for has expired. And if the appellate division agrees with the applicant, then it comes back here and you're charged with hearing the application, with reviewing the application. So it's really very myopic and viewing the issue with blinders for this commission to take the position that it's over. It ain't over. It ain't over until it's over. And the other thing I'd like to say is that if this ad hoc committee with respect to MOA actually comes into fruition, and if members of the public are invited to join, I would be happy to volunteer my services, and I have a CV that I could send to you if you're interested.
Sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
With regard to the other, you're certainly correct in your representation of the status of that application. However, I think our answer is fair in that there is nothing before us. There's nothing we can do. It's beyond our control at this moment.
At this moment. Right.
And may well be for good and for all. So we just have to wait and see.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fishman. Is there anyone else?
Yeah.
Oh, Mr. Wolf, okay. Yeah, if there's no one else.
Wolf again. I need to invite that testimony to clarify something you should be aware of.
Sure.
Because that exact legal opinion that it's over, that there's nothing pending before the commission, was conveyed to the Joint Legislative Committee on Ethical Standards. And on that basis, and on that basis alone, they determined that there was not a quote-unquote contested case for the purposes of an ethics challenge that was filed. And under the ethics law, a legislator is prohibited, there's a flat-out prohibition in the ethics law from communicating with an administrative law judge or an agency head during the pendency of a contested case. Uh-huh. And when counsel for the Joint Legislative Committee on Ethical Standards made inquiry to the commission, they spoke verbally. There was no written analysis, no written opinions, very sloppy legal work again. There was an oral communication over the phone from Ms. Roth, your counsel, to the counsel for the committee. And at the hearing, I was testifying on this, and when this became known to me, I said that's outrageous in terms of its laxity and lack of rigor, and it didn't meet basic minimal legal standards for legal review. But so it's not just the fact that we're having this fight over, hey, this thing could be back if the appellate division remands, but it just undermined, and I heard what you just said was accurate, that you agreed with Mr. Fishman. So you just contradicted your executive director, who...
I think I did.
No, I think you did. I think she said it was dead. Am I correct?
All right, well...
But so, no, my point is, these things are having real-world consequences. All right? And it turned into a he said, she said. And I was saying that just what you heard previously, that it was not over. And on the weight of... I'm not an attorney. On the weight of your attorney's representation, a formal legislative committee dismissed the matter. And that, to me, is pretty significant. And I think it should be significant to you, too. And I think you should up the standard of your work. And that's just my own thing.
Thank you.
If there's no one else, we'll close the public portion.
Mr. Chairman, before we adjourn.
I know you had a comment. Not that we were going to adjourn. I think there was interest in going into closed session, but before we do that,
just a point of order. Not having been at the last policy and implementation meeting in which a lot of this business was discussed. Oh, sorry. As I was not at the last P&I meeting, and some of the issues were covered in the press, and that's important and very good. I'd just like to be clear and ask you directly, what is this imposition of the gag order? To what degree are we, has been imposed upon commissioners? Is the same gag order imposed upon anyone remotely involved with the case, such as South Jersey Gas or BPU officials, or even legislators who may use it in the Judiciary Committee? So what does it truly mean for and to us? How is it applied? Just so I'm clear, because it's troubling.
I would not characterize it as a gag order.
Yes, as it has been noted in the press. So please tell me the problem.
I'm sorry. I think the resolution on its face is pretty clear. I believe it states that the commission is recognizing its statutory obligation to keep things confidential that are confidential. And affirmatively putting on the record that it's not waiving any privileges by reviewing these documents.
Okay, and is that only imposed upon commissioners?
I wouldn't even call it imposed. We're just putting information on the record. It's for the commissioners. You voted on it. Yes.
Okay, thanks for the clarification. Okay.
And I mean, we can talk about this. I think we're going to go into closed session too, so if you have other.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, we have a request from Commissioner Rickley. Oh, another comment? Yeah. Commissioner.
I have a question. With the understanding that there is pending, I guess, litigation on the South Jersey Gas matter, I wanted to ask the executive record directly. Have you received anything new, application, correspondence, anything from South Jersey Gas?
No.
Thank you.
Okay. This is sounding distinctly like a courtroom in here. Yes, Commissioner Lloyd.
I'd like to just comment on Mr. Green's, I don't think we were very clear at the end of the last meeting on what the resolution we passed, and if I can just elaborate it, because correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding was that the purpose of the resolution was, one, to allow us to look at the non-redacted emails, but that we've taken the position in court that there are portions of those emails that are privileged and confidential, and that the purpose of the resolution was nothing we were doing in that resolution was undermining or changing our position in court that those redacted portions were privileged. And so we were making them available to ourselves to look at, but maintaining our position in court. Kristen, is that a fair? I think we did it at the very end of the last meeting after coming out of closed session. I think we might not have been as clear as we should have.
Thank you, Commissioner. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other commissioners?
Four.
Yes.
I don't know if this is the proper time, but I would like to get a feel for the question. I don't know if it would be in the form of a motion to, and not to circumvent your authority, but to make a motion to formulate an agricultural committee. And I don't know where you're at in that process. I don't know if it's proper this time to make a motion to establish an agricultural committee similar to BNI, not wanting to undo your authority as the chairman. And I don't know where you're at with that process, but I'd like to get a feel as to whether the commissioners feel that it would be a good thing to do.
Can I recommend that we do that at the P&I?
Sure.
That I think that would be put, and we can do it at the very next meeting, add that to the agenda, have a discussion of it.
Okay, thank you.
I think that might be good.
Thank you.
All right?
Yep.
Thank you.
All
right. Anyone else? Okay. Now, Commissioner McGlinchey has made a request that we receive an update from counsel on the status of litigation, which, of course, would be a matter we have to go in closed session for. So, I don't know if counsel has to recite any rationale for that.
Yes. Okay.
Whereas the Open Public Meetings Act provides the public bodies such as the Pinelands Commission may be in closed session to discuss any pending or anticipated litigation in which the public body is or may become a party, as well as those matters covered by the attorney-client privilege, as well as matters relating to collective bargaining negotiations. Whereas the commission desires to retire to closed session to discuss those matters, it is therefore resolved the commission shall at this time meet in closed session to discuss the above-mentioned matters. The substance of the closed session will be disclosed publicly only when it will not impede the state's ability to participate in litigation, breach attorney-client privilege, or otherwise not confidential.
Thank you. May I hear a motion to go into closed session to discuss litigation? May I have a motion and a second? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, we are now in closed session. I'd like to ask the public comment to retire. Thank you.